listening to the Walt's World Podcast. Join your hosts, John and Kaylee, as they banter about all things Disney, including Disney parks, resorts, dining, fashion, and movies. They'll keep you up to date with the latest Disney news and rumors, and they'll share their best tips and insight to make sure you have the best Disney vacation possible. So to all who tune into this happy place, welcome. It's the Walt's World Podcast.
Hey friends, it's November the 6th, 2018, and this is episode number 28 of the Walt's World Podcast. I'm your host, John, and with me, as she is every week, she's my friend, she's your friend, Kaylee!
Hello, everyone!
And this is yet another one of our Tuesday Treat episodes. And Kaylee, why don't you tell everybody who we have with us this week?
Okay, so we have Doug Does Disney on Instagram.
Woo! I love you, Doug!
Woo! Yeah. Fangirling so hard. He's a photography wizard. I met him through our pals over at the Zad Crew, CJ, the last time he was down. So that was super exciting. So, of course, I jumped on the opportunity to have him on to talk about all things Disney photography. So, Doug, why don't you talk a little bit about yourself?
Sure, my favorite subject. No. So, about me. I moved down to the Central Florida area just 2.5 years ago. I'm originally from New Hampshire. I lived in the frozen north. I heard rumor that you don't have to shovel sunshine, so I made my way down to Florida after finishing up school and made the permanent move to become a Walt Disney World local.
Nice, nice. So you moved down after you finished up school. So how did the love for Disney start? Was this something as a child you grew up coming down, or you came down one day and decided, hey, I love this, I'm moving here?
So a little bit of both. When I was young, I grew up with Disney movies. I'm pretty sure I watched The Little Mermaid to the point where the tape died and then we had to get a new one. Like, that was my movie.
Yes.
So that love started with the movies when I was young, and it must have been when I was about 5 or 6, my family brought me on my first trip to Walt Disney World. I remember this because my younger sister was 1 or 2 years old. She was very young for coming to Disney, and we came as a family. We stayed at the Polynesian, and it was one of the best vacations I could have ever asked for. And after that vacation, that first time as a family coming down, we had such a great time. We ended up coming once a year as a family during the same time of year and always made our little pilgrimage to Walt Disney World to kind of relive it and be able to experience all the new things that were available.
That's so fun. That's something I definitely missed out on because I have lived in Florida my whole life, so I never got all those Disney trips, special memories as a kid, the couple times I went with my family, but that's amazing. So that's kind of how that all started. What about the photography? So you said you went to college, you got a degree. Was it in photography? How did this start? How did this magnificent Doug Does Disney photography account start?
So that has always been a hobby of mine. I've always loved taking pictures. I actually work in the medical field. I'm a PA, so I work in orthopedic trauma surgery, which is like a very polar opposite thing from taking pictures and making things look pretty. So I work in the surgical field during the day, and in my free time, that's when I like to pick up my camera and kind of use my creative side of my brain. And even though I enjoyed taking pictures, I've always enjoyed it. I had a little tiny digital camera, even when I was in high school and middle school, that I always loved to use. But my love for photography and making videos really ramped up in the last 6 or 7 years. I lived with 2 very good friends of mine. Their names are Sam and Kaylee, and they started a business called Dog Breath Photography. They are incredible dog photographers, so incredible that they inspired me to start taking my own pictures and find the thing that I love the most. So with that, when we moved down here, I started just by, you know, taking pictures with my iPhone, popped them onto Instagram to update the family, and that's how I justified it. And eventually I had that moment where I was like, I want to do more with this. Like, I want more to play with when these pictures. What am I going to do? So from there, got my first big DSLR in a very long time, and it kind of grew from there.
And the editing and all of that, that just came naturally, or that was kind of your own studying on the side?
A lot of self-teaching. So YouTube is the most incredible resource for learning how to edit photos. And when you see a photographer that you like, you have that moment, I wish my picture could look kind of like that. A lot of them have tutorials online on their YouTube channel. So I would take all of those and use them for my own, and eventually formed my own kind of style from all of these different styles that I had learned from. But no formal teaching, just a lot of research and study and looking things up on free sources like YouTube.
You have a lot of things on your plate.
I like being busy. I don't sleep
very much.
Medical
star by day, photography star by night. No big deal. Jack of all trades.
Something I want to know, Doug, is there's I heard a story. I think I heard you share it on another podcast, but I think it's a really cool story for people to hear about how, like, you and Emmy, your significant other,
yep,
lovely Emmy, how you guys kind of were down at Disney on a trip and at Pop, and yep, something happened medically and all that jazz. Give us like the 411 on all that.
So I was finishing up school. I had my first vacation from school in almost 2 years. And where else would I go but that place that, you know, hooks into your childhood and you can just let go and be carefree, but Disney. So we flew in, picked up our bags, went over to Pop Century. I think we may have gone out the night before just to see fireworks. And the next morning I wake up and all of a sudden my chest feels tight. The whole right side of my chest felt wrong. I ignored it. Medical people are the worst when it comes to the thought of it couldn't ever happen to me. So I was hurt and I ignored it, went back to bed. Woke up again because of that pain in my chest. I was like, you know what? I'll probably get some coffee. I'm a big coffee person. So I'm like, I'll get some coffee. Caffeine will pump me up. I'll feel better. Walked over to the food court area at Pop, and I had to take a break to walk the however many hundred yards to get to the food court and catch my breath. I was like, that's kind of weird. But again, medical person, we ignore it, strive on, move towards, got coffee, had coffee, still didn't feel better. Eventually, I took a hot shower. This is like 2 hours had gone by. Took a hot shower, gosh, Thought that would loosen me up. And I knew something was really wrong, so I was planning on going to an urgent care. But all of a sudden, in between breaths, I could only get out maybe 3 words. And at that point, I was like, okay, something's much more wrong than I realized. So I was actually in transition, moving to a new location, new home. I had my stethoscope with me, gave myself a listen, and I had no sounds on the right side of my chest for breathing. So I knew right then my entire right lung had collapsed. I was in trouble, and I needed to be in an ER in the next 20 minutes because I had been ignoring it for so long, and I was starting to feel a little lightheaded and didn't feel good.
Oh, my gosh.
So luckily, my buddy, Brendan, and his girlfriend, Amanda, they're friends from undergrad way long ago, lived in the area, and they were already on the way over to pick us up and bring us to urgent care. He's an EMT, so I was like, you know what? He's already here. He's here faster than ambulance, and if something goes down, he'll be able to help me out. So picked us up, drove us to Celebration Hospital, got there, and within about 5 minutes of being in the doors, I had a chest tube and they reinflated my lung. And about 2 weeks later, I ended up having to have surgery and had about a quarter of my right lung taken out. All because of just, you know, feeling a little cramped up, or so I thought. But during this whole experience, during the hospital stay and the time that me and Emmy, this was our vacation. So Emmy had some time off to be down with me. So she took care of everything. I couldn't ask for a better partner in crime when we are in a tight situation. So she took care of everything. We had a lot of big conversations during that time when I'm just sitting there in the hospital bed and couldn't do much of anything. And one of the conversations we had was this, like, you know, life's short. Like, this is something that if I hadn't been on it, hadn't like gotten to the hospital fast enough, I could have died. You never know. So that's when we started to decide that we wanted to move and relocate to Disney, because that is one of the places that we're the happiest.
So you kind of took that opportunity. You're like, hey, I might be on my deathbed. Let's move to Disney.
Oh, I milked it. It was really bad. Like, I had always thought about moving to Disney as one of those, oh, maybe when. But this was the chance to be like, you know what, maybe now is the time. And I meant it in a serious note, but I also knew that I kind of had the upper hand. And she knew it, too. She was like, you can't do this when you're in a hospital bed. I was like, right. Okay, fair. Like, I am milking it a little bit.
Maybe I need to, like, hurt one of my lungs or hurt something and get in the hospital. That way I can convince my wife, hey,
it got me here.
Just move to
it
Disney.
Got me here.
Life's short. Let's go.
So what, you finished up college and then moved down after graduation?
Yep. So after I graduated, I only looked for jobs within the Orlando area. That was my focus. And with that, we started our planning on moving. We saved up money. We already had some money saved up to move wherever we were going to go, but we kind of directed all of that towards moving from, originally we both lived up in New Hampshire and coming down to the Orlando area. Eventually I found a job. I flew down for the interview, said hey, did a quick Disney trip on the side. And when I flew back, we had everything locked in, what my start date was going to be and when we'd be able to actually pull the trigger.
That's crazy. That's like one of the probably craziest stories I'll hear like my whole life about somebody moving down to Disney.
Yeah, it was, it's not conventional by any means, but I mean, not everybody's stories are when they're trying to move down to Disney World. I mean,
right.
Who does that?
I know. Justification.
What kind of reaction do you get from people maybe back home or friends that, like when you say you have, you know, a large following on Instagram because you take photos at Disney World, like what are people's reaction to like a grown man, you know, being so into Disney?
You know, that's something that comes a lot in this sphere, within podcasts, within making videos or photos. It's, you know, you're an adult. Why do you like Disney? That's for kids. And your listeners, I'm sure, know it's not just for kids. There are so many things that are so interesting to do around Walt Disney World. I mean, I thought I'd be able to get a good bite of it done within the last 2 years. I feel like I haven't even scratched the surface. So that's what I try and explain. I'm like, there are so many neat places to eat. There are places to go out. If you do choose to drink alcohol, there are all these cool bars that have these amazing themings. And I bring up places like the Edison in Disney Springs. Mm-hmm. They have the most incredible entertainment, aerial dancers, live bands, swing dancing, you name it. And then I asked them, I was like, does that sound like a kid place to you? And they're like, no, that actually sounds kind of all right. Exactly. There's so much more to it.
Yeah. It's a daily basis for me. I think I get questions like, why, like, you don't have kids, but why do you go to Disney? It's so hard to explain. And I've convinced a lot of my coworkers, though. I've kind of turned them around on the idea of adult Disney a little bit. But it's a crazy thing, especially podcasting. I know Kaylee gets it a lot. Like, people are like, you have a podcast. What's it about? And we're like, Disney. And they're like, why? Like, mm-hmm. It's just... And like, well, some people hunt and fish. Some people, you know, go out on the lake and stuff like that. Like, we just go to Disney and podcast about it.
Yeah. And that's what you enjoy. And part of me says, you don't even need to justify it. If you like it, if you have fun, it's not hurting anybody else, go for it.
There's a lot worse things you could be involved in than going to Disney.
Right.
Cheaper things, but...
I have trouble justifying it, and I've lived here my whole life. So, I mean, I can't imagine, like, being somewhere and justifying the fact, oh, I come down every year to Disney, you know, and I'm whatever. So, yeah, it's a lot of fun. And I think people don't realize all of the hidden gems that Disney has to offer. Like,
absolutely.
Aside from just, like, Cinderella's castle that, you know, everybody thinks Magic Kingdom is just for kids or whatever. But... it's amazing, and there's so much. And speaking of so much, the community, the Instagram community, I'm sure you have a lot more insight on the photography Disney Instagram community than we do, so talk a little bit about that. I'm sure you've met some amazing people. I mean, I feel like we basically met via Instagram. I mean, we met through somebody that I met through Instagram that you probably met through Instagram.
Oh,
so
totally.
It's crazy how things start tying together.
I mean, other than the people, if you've checked out our YouTube channel, you've probably met Matt and Shayna. So they just moved down here. But other than them, all of my friends down here, I've met through Instagram. Like, that's the social networking aspect. It's either you met someone through Instagram and then you met someone else through a friend of a friend, or you met them directly through social media. It's a really cool group of people, and it's a group of people that likes to spend time together. So the Disney photography community, I got pulled in through a couple of individuals. The first person that ever talked to me because of my Instagram was a girl named Lisa. Her Instagram handle is Lisa Disney or Lisa.Disney. And she saw that we were at the same Christmas party together. So she shot me a little message through like stories or the little direct message, a little DM. She was like, "Hey, I'm at the party too. Want to say hey?" And I was like, "Okay, like sure. This is like kind of weird, but I don't know." And through her, I met the group called Disney Colors, which is a Facebook group that is all focused on Disney photography. And they do, or try to do, at least a monthly meetup where everybody gets together and we all go to shoot one specific thing, whether it be fireworks or close down a park, and we all go together to do it. And that's how I met almost everybody that I hang out with down here in the Orlando area in general. So that's been that great connector, and everybody's super friendly and very eager to share what they know or different angles that you might want to try when it comes to taking a photo of something as iconic as the castle that there's probably infinite photos of out on the internet. But to do it a little bit different is kind of their focus, and that's how I met everybody, and it's always a really good time spending time with them. And I still spend time with them 2 years later.
That's amazing. It is. That's why I love this community, is everybody's so nice. Like, I've never met somebody, I mean, I'm sure there are, like, you know, there's people everywhere that aren't, don't have the best intentions, but everybody that I personally met is so welcoming. Like, even you, the day that I met you, you were just like, "Hi, I'm Doug," and then we just start talking about whatever, and, you know, it turns into this, so here we are. It's just, it's amazing how, like, genuine people are. And especially when you share a love, that's what brings everything together. So you share the love of Disney, so then you share it and you find other people that you love and you love to hang out with. You talked a little bit about the YouTube. Talk a little bit about more. I love the videos. I love the intro. The one that you showed me when we first met with the portal, the editing is just amazing. You and Emmy do like the top fives. I watched your photo pass one. I watched you and Matt doing all the rides at Epcot before noon. So how did you transition from, "Hey, this is an awesome photography account," to, "Hey, let's make an awesome YouTube account"?
And thank you for the high praises. I'm just a guy who takes pictures. But YouTube came along because I felt that Instagram is something that is very fleeting. You take the picture, you post the picture, it goes up, but after maybe 12, 24, 48 hours, no one sees it ever again. And what I like to do is I like helping people out with their vacations. Like, I like being able to contact people and be like, "Hey, if you're going to do this, make sure you try this," and, you know, enhance the thing for them, their vacation, that I already love so much. And that's that. I just get the most joy out of that, is being able to give just a little suggestion and someone takes it. And then you get the message back months later, once they've already done their trip, like, "Thank you. I went to that place you suggested for food. That was the best thing. I love this about it." And, you know, it makes you feel good. And YouTube for me seemed to be that channel, that outlet that I could have to be able to work with my really good friends and my girlfriend, Emmy, to be able to create something that could enhance other people's vacations, that wouldn't just disappear in an instant. Instead, it lasts and people search for it and they find it. That's something that was very important to me. And I get to be my same goofy self and get creative in a totally new venue. I thought video was going to come easier because I knew something about taking pictures. I couldn't have been more wrong, because it is so much more complicated once you get into it. So that was a big thing for me, as a new creative outlet, helping people out with their Disney vacations and creating something that lasts instead of something that's fleeting and disappears just after a moment.
I do video for a living for the U.S. government, which sounds really exciting. but it's something that I love. And watching your editing in the YouTube on your YouTube channel, your guys' intro and a lot of the in between stuff where you're just kind of like doing some B-roll shots and stuff. The colors are so great and the movement. Why don't you talk a little bit about, like, do you do any color grading, things like that, and what kind of equipment do you use video-wise? And then we'll talk about photography stuff.
Sure. And thank you on the intro, because that was literally the first thing I ever recorded, period, that wasn't on an iPhone. So
really?
That's, like, a big deal. Oh, yeah. That was – it took multiple days. We had to only go when the sunset was similar. Like, it was so – we had to wear the same exact clothes. Like, oh, my God.
Shed a tear when I first watched it and you guys hold hands at the end.
Yeah.
And then you see her little mini ring. I'm like, oh, I love Disney so much.
She's a gem.
And this is why.
She's a gem. So when it comes to editing – most of our videos have been shot on a Canon 5D Mark IV. If there's anything that you see at the water parks that's involved with getting wet, or I think we did a video on Blizzard Beach not too long ago where we actually took the camera on the rides with us. I have a much smaller camera. I have a little G7X made by Canon, and I got a scuba housing for it so I could take it to the water parks. So I have this big underwater housing for this tiny little camera, and that's part of the equipment we take around with us. Recently, I have done something blasphemous. I have gone and converted from Canon, and I now shoot
Don't
with
say
a
it.
Sony A7 III.
Oh, that's not bad, though.
Okay, okay. Nope. So I changed over to Sony because their current mirrorless cameras can do everything that I want. It's not just take a nice picture, but I can shoot slow motion in 1080. I can shoot the rest of my footage in 4K. And when it comes together, I can do all of this in one space, and I don't have to be switching between one camera and the next to be able to get what I want out of a video. So my bag has gone from a massive camera bag where I had four different lenses and two different camera bodies to I bring one body, one lens, which is the 24-70, my favorite lens I could ever ask for, and that's in a couple batteries. So I'm not breaking my back anymore, and I'm still getting the quality that I want out of the camera itself. As for editing, I do color grading. I do all my editing in Premiere, so I use the Adobe suite. And then if I ever do graphics, like you were saying of the portal, Kayla was talking about that, I created a portal in After Effects, and that's where I do that. So it's all within that same Adobe suite. And again, YouTube videos, just learn from everybody who knows better than you do already. And I'm still doing that. I mean, there isn't a day where I'm doing a video, I'm like, oh yeah, I know how to do it's every time like, I don't know how to do this anymore. Like, I'm stuck. And then you go to the internet and you find what you want, and then you transition into doing something a little bit more than you were doing before.
That's awesome.
And the YouTube channel is We Do Disney. I'm not sure if we mentioned that, but it's We Do Disney. So you have Doug Does Disney, Emmy Does Disney, We Do Disney on the YouTube.
Yes.
Bring
we,
it all
we
together.
Brought it together.
So with that in mind, let me ask you this. It's kind of a funny question, but who decided, like, okay, Doug Does Disney, Emmy Does Disney, separate accounts, not just one? Like, was that like, did you start yours first? How did that go?
I started mine first because I like social media, and I have been taking photos for a long time. So it was natural for me to be like, oh, this platform makes sense for me. I convert it. I don't even remember what my old Instagram name was, but I transitioned it all over to Doug Does Disney. I thought the alliteration was fun. And I started that. Maybe a year later, Emmy started her Instagram. Being very transparent, Emmy does not love social media by any mind. Like, she's the kind of person, she could leave her phone at home and she'd be so happy to do so, which I love because it evens me out a little bit. I sometimes think I'm a little too much on the social or the connected side. So she made her account a little bit later. She's active when she wants to be on that account. But collectively doing the videos is a little bit easier because I can handle some of the technical stuff, but she still loves making them and creating ideas for them.
Cool.
I'm sure our listeners are curious and maybe they want to, you know, get started on their own Disney photography account. Mm-hmm. So what advice do you maybe have for somebody starting out in maybe photography in general, specifically Disney photography? Maybe just something like you wish you would have known when you started that you can share.
Sure. One of the most important things to know when starting photography in general is the best camera you can get is the one that you will have with you. If you're thinking, I need this big DSLR, I need this fancy camera to be able to get the image that I want, it's just not true. Start with what you got, find out what you love, and then you'll learn over time what kind of gear you're going to need to be able to do what you want to do. I started off probably, I don't know if I would say the wrong way. I started off with my iPhone, which was perfect. I always had it with me. I could take a picture. It would look pretty good. And I could share it on Instagram. And it worked, right? You could use little editing tools like Snapseed or Lightroom for mobile. And those tools can enhance what you're doing with your iPhone already. At some point, you will outgrow that. And you'll know because you'll look at a picture and be like, I wish I could take a picture like that. And you Google how to do it and it says you need this equipment or this, you need a little remote control for your camera to be able to take a long exposure of some fireworks. And you say, okay, I need to find an entry level camera that will allow me to do this. Because honestly, the difference between the cameras that I've used, I mean, you could even consider my change from the Canon 5D Mark IV to my Sony I have now as a downgrade. Some people call it that. It's a cheaper camera. It has less expensive. If it's smaller, it doesn't have as big a feature, but it does all the things that I want to do. And that is the most important file. Find out what you want to do. And then when it comes, this is just equipment speaking. Find out what you want to do and then find out what you need to be able to do it. Don't go spending crazy money on a camera that you won't get as much out of until you know how to use it. That's a big thing for me because I probably went a little too deep too quick. Like I'm the kind of person, I thought I needed this big camera with all this extra stuff and I probably would have been happier with something a little bit smaller early on. And when it comes to getting into the Disney photo community, reach out to people. If you're going to be going and taking pictures and go on a trip, meet someone, reach out to someone on Instagram. If you see on stories they're in the same place, at least just say hey or ask questions. Like I'm always happy to answer questions. If you shoot me a direct message, I don't think I ever let them slide, especially when it comes to photo stuff. If you shoot me a message and you have a question about Disney photos, gear, and if I'm in this park at the same time as you, I am more than willing to say hey, because that's, I actually take social media from the social standpoint. Like it's how I connect with all these wonderful people who have the same interest as me. Talk to me. Like I would love to answer questions and do the same thing. Ask people questions, get into it, get into the little community, find your niche and then go shoot with people. This is one of those, it's strange at this point to ask people, hey, do you want to go hang out that you might not know really well? Want to go hang out at the Magic Kingdom and go take pictures? Every once in a while, you get a, of course. Like, yeah, that'd be a ton of fun. And then you go and you meet a friend and then you meet a friend of a friend. And I don't know, my love for the Disney photography aspect started when I started meeting people. And that was a big thing for me. And that's how I got connected down in a place where I didn't have any friends. I just wanted to meet some people. It sounds kind of sad. It wasn't sad. It was fun. But like, it's be social, I guess, is the big takeaway there. And don't overdo it with spending a ton of money on something you may or may not need.
How do you manage not just the fact that you're down there now and kind of still being in love with the parks, but how do you manage going to the parks and not just looking at it as a photo opportunity here or a photo opportunity here, but yet just kind of have fun still?
That was a struggle for me. I used to always take my camera to the park, always ready to shoot, always ready to record, especially recently. So Emily and I have identified there are times when we go to the parks and I don't bring my camera. I have to leave it at home because I do get a little obsessive. So leaving it at home and creating time to be able to be present in whatever you're doing instead of looking at it as an opportunity for something later or a photo, just separating yourself from your gear, that did it for me.
And that's true. Like, even just being involved in the Instagram community, there's always like pressure, like, oh, I should be on my story sharing this, mm-hmm. or I should be doing this or that. So yeah, it's always important. I mean, just in life, to like just set some personal time aside to just mm-hmm. take it all in and get back to like the reason why you loved it, and not just work or whatever the case may be.
I know I want to look back. I want to look back in all my experiences at Disney and in life in general, is I want to look back and have experienced them not through the lens, through a lens, but like yeah. through my own eye, you know, not yeah. not through the lens of a camera. So
yes.
that's kind of the way I see it.
This is just a curiosity of mine. What's your favorite picture you've ever taken?
Oh gosh. Do I have it in this room? My favorite picture, actually, I could get it. It was very early on. Emily and I went to Disneyland for both of our first times during the last week of their 60th. It was for, we saw Paint the Night. We saw the fire. It was incredible. So I took this picture, and I'll send it to you guys. I have it hanging. We have it hanging above our bed. It is us in front of the castle. No one is there. We were the last people in the park, and we're holding hands, and you can see the archway of the castle going back towards their carousel underneath where we're holding hands. So we're kind of spread apart, looking at each other. It's my favorite picture because it was such a special trip, a special moment for us, because we were staying real late and the park was closing oddly early, and we just had this one opportunity, and I had my camera, plopped it down. It was on the ground. I was propping it up with a lens cap or something like that. Nothing special, but we hit the little timer, got this one shot, and it's been hanging above our bed ever since.
That's awesome.
That's amazing. Oh, yeah, I love
that's
that.
Gotta be my favorite.
I love that. So we'll do a little merch plug too while we're here. You do have some t-shirts that you sell.
Yeah.
So, well, I mean, they're sold through a different shop, right?
Right. They're sold through NRGTs, which if you've ever listened
boo,
to
the, Greg, boo.
Yeah, exactly. Greg, he's a troublemaker, but he was gracious enough to be able to work with me and figure out a way to do some We Do Disney t-shirts. I like it because it's not like, it is branding for us, but it's really not. We've had a lot of people compliment if, like, me and Emily are wearing them in the parks. It's like a cute couple's shirt. It's like, oh, we do Disney. Oh, you two do it. That's so cute. Like,
it
so
is, it doesn't,
yeah. It doesn't have to be, like, branding, but it can also be one of those shirts where you're going with a group of people and you can wear them. It does have our logo real big on the back, but it's the castle with clouds and little hills and stuff like that. It's cute. So we have those over at NRGTs. We also have tank tops and stuff because Florida, I mean, really, yeah. sleeves are somewhat overrated here. And we've got some other stuff that'll be coming out in the semi-near future, but there's a lot of stuff in the works over in the YouTube and merch land.
Yeah. And that's so inspiring that you're so, community involved or community oriented, I should say. That's awesome. I know our viewers love that. Or viewers, like, we're on YouTube. I wish we were on YouTube right now, YouTube Live. No, but our listeners, you know, we're all about community and sharing the knowledge. That's why we started this, because we wanted to share our knowledge of the parks and potentially help somebody who's coming down for vacation. So mm-hmm. it's amazing. And it's seriously such a pleasure to have met you and to have you on. So thank you so much.
Oh, it was a blast. Yes. I really enjoyed this.
Well, we're not done yet. We have the best part to come.
All right.
Yes.
Lightning round.
Lightning round. So we're going to do the lightning round. John's going to say it as fast as he can, the question. You have to reply as fast as you can, and it'll just keep going, 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 going. So the first thing that comes to your mind, just say it. And John will repeat the next one.
My hands are clammy now.
Okay.
All right.
Good. 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 All right. So, first one. Favorite ride at the Magic Kingdom?
Small World, honestly.
Oh, okay. Hold on. We're going to stop the live
bring
now
it back,
for a second.
Bring it back.
Why? Why Small World?
I don't know if it's partially because during my early trips. Like, those were one of the rides that I could go on. And then my father would harass me with that song for the next year until we returned to Disney. And somehow that became a good memory. But I also, the message is wonderful that we're all in this together, all one world. And I just, I don't know, maybe it's air conditioning. I have no idea. But overall, I love that ride. And I always have. I know, really weird one to pick. It's not Thrill Ride. It's slow and most people hate it, but it's one of my favorites.
Well, that's okay.
Do you like all the one at Disneyland? No, wait. Do you like the one at Disneyland better or the one at Walt Disney World?
Disneyland, by far. Are you kidding? There's characters. Arrows floating around in there. It's so good.
Stitch. I know. It's so good. Okay, back to lightning. Quick.
All right. Okay. All right, back to it. All right. Favorite table service?
Tiffin's.
Favorite quick service?
Satouli Canteen.
Perfect. Favorite Disney princess? I know the answer to this one.
Snow White. She's OG. Whoa. Oh, yeah.
Wow. I thought you were going to say Ariel. Okay.
No, you would think, but Snow White's she's the original. She's classic.
Favorite Disney sidekick?
Abu.
The one Disney snack you could never live without?
Mickey Premium Bar.
Flower and Garden or Food and Wine Festival?
Flower and Garden.
Perfect. Favorite of the four parks?
I have to say Magic Kingdom. You can't not say Magic Kingdom.
For our friend Lou Review Matt, favorite bathroom at Disney?
All right. I did my research and I listened to your podcast before, and when I heard this question, I was distraught. Can I have two? I'm taking two, and I'm not even going to ask two. So one, the Tangled bathrooms are awesome. They're really cool. They're aesthetic, and the frying pans and all the stuff, that's great. When it comes to, if you want the quietest spot ever, it is the second floor of Pizza Rizzo at Hollywood Studios. There's a bathroom on the first floor, but there's also a bathroom on the second floor, and no one goes there. If you want to just be alone, if you're one of those really private people, that's the place.
No one goes there or to Pizza Rizzo. So
I know, exactly. The whole second floor is clear. I don't know.
All right. Favorite Disney prince, or for those that aren't princes, friend of a Disney princess. So, like, Flynn Rider is not a prince technically, but...
Okay, that's fair. I think Aladdin would have to be my pick.
It's a good choice. Favorite non-Pixar Disney movie?
Ooh, non-Pixar Disney movie. Peter Pan?
Perfect. That's the correct answer.
Okay.
Favorite Disney World area music?
The main entrance area in front of Spaceship Earth at Epcot.
Yes. MGM or Hollywood Studios?
MGM. Wait, what's Hollywood Studios? Never heard of that.
Seriously.
Your favorite color magic band of their original colors?
Red.
What is the must-have, can't-live-without object in your park bag other than all your camera equipment?
My fuel rod.
Awesome. Awesome. That's it. That's all questions. You killed it.
Lightning round. I survived. Hey, I thought I was going to clamber through that. That was okay.
No, you probably did one of the best as far as answering the quickest. But I have a question because I need somebody on my side. Do you miss the Sorcerer Mickey hat at Hollywood?
Of course. Yes. Yes, of course I miss Sorcerer Mickey. Partially, especially, I never got to photograph it. There is one picture that I have with it in the photo, and it's of me and Emmy on our first trip where we went with different family members and stuff like that. But our first big group trip to Disney, we got a picture in front of that. That was before we were dating, before we were a thing. I'm pretty sure there was before any of this started, but we have one picture in front of that hat.
See, I miss it so much, and John gives me such hate for it. And even like CJ was talking smack about it too. I'm like, I love the hat. I miss the hat.
Listen, they can be wrong about something. That's okay. We'll let that slide.
How can you like MGM and not Hollywood Studios, but yet like the Sorcerer's hat? That's just like blaspheme.
I'm a very conflicting person. I just like to throw wrenches in everything I can.
Nice. Awesome. Well, cool. That's awesome. You killed that. Definitely better than anyone else that we've had. And yeah, that's a shot at everyone else we've had. So, Doug, thank you so much for being on here with us and taking the time to hang out and talk a little photography, videography stuff, and Disney, of course.
Of course, it was a ton of fun. Again, it's all about the community, meeting cool people, and being able to spend time and join the thing that we all like the most.
Yes, thank you. It's seriously been a pleasure.
Community over competition. That's the big saying, right? So
yes.
Go check out Doug on Instagram, Doug Does Disney, and check out his lovely, lovely partner in crime, Emmy Does Disney. And then, of course, head over to YouTube and check them out, We Do Disney, as well. And give them a follow and subscribe and a thumbs up and all that other YouTube jargon stuff that we don't do on Instagram. Thank you so much, Doug, for being here. We really appreciate it. And so that's going to do it for this episode of the Walt's World Podcast. We hope you enjoyed it. If you have any questions or comments for us, you can email us, waltzworldpodcast@gmail.com, or hit us up on Instagram at waltzworldpodcast. So with that, I'm John.
And I'm Kaylee. We'll see you next week.